Hello, I'm Stephen Frazier. On the day of his inauguration, John F. Kennedy proclaimed, "The torch has been passed to a new generation." The death of Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis reminds us that generation now is beginning to pass away. What have we as a people lost? What was it about her that was so special? The glamour, the wealth, the quiet pride of power and privilege. The Kennedys, after all, have been called America's royalty. But if Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis had all that, she also tasted the full measure of the dark side of America. Adulation that becomes obsession. The end of privacy, and of course, the violence. Hers is a story that is part history, part fantasy, part mythology, and part nightmare. We shared her public joy and grief, and in the end, her story is our story. In a moment, a CNN special report, Jackie, A Life of Dignity. Don't let it be forgot that once there was a spot for one brief shining moment that was known as Camelot. The words of a song written by Alan J. Lerner. But say Camelot to someone over 40, and there's a good chance the first association that comes to mind won't be King Arthur, but John and Jackie Kennedy. They were young and sophisticated, rich and powerful, and in those post-war years, we thought of the United States in those terms, too.
So now, my wife and I prepare for a new administration and for a new baby.
Jackie Kennedy was 31 when she moved into the White House, much younger than the three first ladies just before her. They called this renewed place Camelot, the romantic kingdom of Arthur and his round table knights. Much of it was Jackie's doing. She had a breathy voice and a vulnerable manner, but she was at ease with international leaders, charming them, sometimes in their own languages.
One of the Kennedys does not need an interpreter, so I'd like to have my wife say just a word to you.
Estas cosas deberían estar al alcance de todos y no limitarse a unos pocos afortunados.
After a trip to France, the president described himself as the man who accompanied Jackie Kennedy to Paris. She turned receptions at the White House into gatherings of artists and intellectuals. Pablo Casals was her guest there. The president's tastes ran to Frank Sinatra.
People seem so interested in whatever the first family likes. That's where I think one can lead. One doesn't know whether one leads in the right direction enough. One hopes one does.
The restoration of the White House itself was her personal project. She raised the money needed and scoured the nation for paintings and antiques, drawing on her own personal knowledge of fine things to make the White House a showcase for America's best.
I remember the first time I came here as a child. I was 11 years old, and my mother brought me here on Easter vacation. When I think of all the school children who come through here, I think there should be flowers when there can be, and fires going, and the pictures, and to make it look rather like a home and not so frightening.
I don't think the White House ever can completely belong to one person. It belongs to the people of America. And I think whoever lives in it, the First Lady, should preserve its traditions and enhance it and leave something of herself there. But she shouldn't just leave it an empty museum.
Jacqueline Lee Bouvier enjoyed a privileged upbringing. Born July 28, 1929, to wealthy stockbroker John Blackjack Bouvier and Janet Lee Bouvier, Jackie was her daddy's little princess. She idolized her father, despite his reputation as a hopeless alcoholic, a womanizer, and a spendthrift. In 1947, Jackie had her coming out party, and the 18-year-old beauty was named Debutante of the Year. She also entered Vassar College that year and then went on to study French literature at the Sorbonne in Paris and at George Washington University. Upon completing her education, she took a job as the inquiring camera girl for the Washington Times Herald. One of her interview subjects, Senator John F. Kennedy, the young war hero from Massachusetts. He would court her relentlessly. They married on September 12, 1953.
Senator and Mrs. Leverett Saltonstall, screen celebrity Marion Davies, and former Ambassador and Mrs. Joseph Kennedy, parents of the groom, are among the personalities on hand to make this the top society wedding of the year.
A merger, really. Her old money and class, his political clout. The young couple would come to embody the closest thing to royalty the United States has ever known.
Church, it's a real storybook wedding. A radiant
bride. The senator's 24-year-old wife managing to look terrific even during domestic errands like a trip to the cobbler's or the grocer's or a walk with the dog. As a young wife and mother, Jackie proved to be an asset to JFK as he campaigned for the presidency. She invited cameras into their Georgetown home. And although she shunned the public spotlight, often choosing to stay behind while he was on the road, Jackie still made a great impact on the race, wooing Hispanic voters to vote for her husband.
Que viva Kennedy.
And inserting women's issues into the campaign during a discussion with the most popular baby doctor of the day, Dr. Benjamin Spock.
So often in letters from women that I've gotten who seem to be the most concerned in that subject, they say that they often have to sacrifice their children's education because they're overcome with bills to take care of aging parents. It seems such an impossible and tragic choice to have to make.
The combination of JFK's good looks, youth, and vigor, and Jackie's glamour and allure appealed to many Americans. And on November 8, 1960, they went to the polls to give their support to the Democratic nominee. It had been a bitterly contested race against the Republican ticket headed by Richard Nixon. But when the votes were counted, by the slimmest of margins, John F. Kennedy was the victor.
I want Senator Kennedy to know, and I want all of you to know, that certainly if this trend does continue, and he does become our next president, that he will have my wholehearted support.
The young couple was headed to the White House. During official ceremonies such as this trip to India, she was dazzling. The hair, the gowns, the sense of fun.
It was such informality that captured the imagination of the Indian people. The First Lady's visit has been a personal triumph in the diplomacy of goodwill.
What captured the imagination of American people was the presence of a family in the White House, children in the Oval Office. Caroline and John John, who was born between the election and the inauguration. Mrs. Kennedy made it clear her role as mother came first.
Doesn't matter what else you do, if you don't do that part well, if you fail your husband and your children. That really is the role which means the most to me, though obviously I have a deep sense of obligation for the others, but that's the one that comes first.
Her toughest task, providing privacy for her children as they took their places in the high-voltage life of the Kennedy clan. Vacations were active, and the press was always near, watching astronaut John Glenn visit Hyannisport.
Mrs. Kennedy swims with astronaut John Glenn, a weekend guest, before they team up to put on an aqua show of their own. The president stays on the sidelines as Mrs. Kennedy and high-flying Glenn practically go into orbit aboard water skis.
There's so little privacy. I don't mind for myself, but I think it's very hard with them. For instance, I wanted to take my daughter to the circus last week, and I decided I just shouldn't because I would ruin it for her. I worked so hard to make her little ballet school a private thing that we could do together. And there were all the photographers waiting when we got there. So it's a little hard.
The sailing, the touch football, the swimming. Happy pictures of youth and health that almost obscured the tragedies. The stillborn daughter. The son born prematurely who lived only one day. The president's rumored infidelities.
I think that Jackie must have known that she didn't have the entire devotion, a real devotion from her husband, although I think she had his admiration. And I think near the end of his administration, they were closer and he understood and appreciated her more.
He appreciated her at his side during the tough assignments, including the fence-mending trip to Dallas that would ultimately provide the most enduring image of Jackie.
We lost the Arthur part of Camelot, and now Guinevere's starting to follow. You know, it's kind of unfortunate, but the Kennedys are like, they're part of American lore. That's the best way I could put it.
And I think we all felt that we knew her personally. I only saw her once, and she was beautiful.
November 22nd, 1963, the bullet that struck the president stung people around the world. It made us feel like we'd lost a friend, and all things stopped except time. We gathered around our televisions, and in our sorrow, we found a new reason for admiring the young, glamorous woman, the First Lady of the land. First dressed in blood-stained pink, then in widow's black. President Kennedy arrived with Jackie at Love Field in Dallas to cheers and a bouquet of roses for the First Lady. The president's goal, to mend a rift in the state's Democratic Party.
Parkland Hospital, there has been a shooting. Parkland Hospital has been advised to stand by for a severe gunshot wound.
That's an unconfirmed report that the president was hit in the head. The president's wife, Jackie Kennedy, was not hurt. She walked into the hospital at her husband's stretcher side.
The President of the United States is dead.
Jackie Kennedy, elegant even in grief, stood at Lyndon Johnson's side as he took the oath of office, only 99 minutes after her husband's life ebbed away.
I solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
Steadfast in death as in life, she accompanies her beloved on his lonely ride.
News of the president's death stunned, touching hearts across the nation. But Jackie Kennedy bore her sorrow and that of a nation with dignity. As a source of strength for the 250,000 people who waited in a line of mourners that stretched 10 miles from the Capitol. And for two who followed her to the White House, Lady Bird Johnson and later President Bill Clinton.
In times of hope, she captured our hearts. In tragedy, her courage helped salve a nation's grief.
She carried the grief of her family and our entire nation with a calm power that somehow reassured all the rest of us.
From the Capitol, the slain president's body was taken to St. Matthew's Cathedral, six blocks away, for a funeral mass. Even in her grief, the 34-year-old widow gently reminded her son to salute his father's body as it left for its final resting place in Arlington National Cemetery. The image of the young widow and her patriotic son made their way onto the cover of Look and Life, two of America's most popular magazines, and they were indelibly etched onto the nation's consciousness. Former First Lady Nancy Reagan.
The picture of her at her husband's funeral was one that will always be remembered by all of us, of her standing with her two children and walking with Teddy and Bobby.
Through it all, Jackie Kennedy never lost her grace or her graciousness. Liz Carpenter, former press secretary to Lady Bird Johnson, saved a handwritten letter written to Lyndon Johnson one day after the funeral. Carpenter read from the letter three decades later.
Dear Mr. President, thank you for walking yesterday behind Jack. You did not have to do that. I'm sure many people forbid you to take such a risk, but you did it anyway. Thank you for your letters to my children. What those letters will mean to them later, you can imagine. The touching thing is they've always loved you so much. They were most moved to have a letter from you now. And most of all, Mr. President, thank you for the way you've always treated me, the way you and Lady Bird have always been to us, before when Jack was alive and now as president.
And she publicly thanked well-wishers as she and her family left the White House for their Georgetown home.
I want to take this opportunity to express my appreciation for the hundreds of thousands of messages, nearly 800,000 in all, which my children and I have received over the past few weeks. The knowledge of the affection in which my husband was held by all of you has sustained me, and the warmth of these tributes is something I shall never forget. Whenever I can bear to, I read them. All his bright light gone from the world. All of you who have written to me know how much we all loved him and that he returned that love in full measure. It is my greatest wish that all of these letters be acknowledged. They will be, but it will take a long time to do so. But I know you will understand. Each and every message is to be treasured, not only for my children, but so that future generations will know how much our country and people in other nations thought of him.
President Kennedy's assassination ended a chapter in American history. It was Jackie Kennedy who helped turn the page.
Well, I somehow feel that she'll go down in history almost as memorable as her husband.
Her elegance, I think there will be no one like her.
She set a standard that probably has not or probably will not be met by many other women in this country.
And I feel very sad because somebody I know has died.
This CNN special report, Jackie, A Life of Dignity, will continue in a moment.
She was a 34-year-old widow with two young children. She quickly became a reminder of an era to which we could not return, but she refused to remain an icon. She showed us she was a human being, looking for love, looking for independence, looking for, we could scarcely believe it, another life. The 1,000 days were up. Camelot was over. The mother turned her energies to raising the fatherless Caroline and John John. Tough times to bring up children. The death of her husband ushered in an age of upheaval, the war in Vietnam. And the violent reaction against it by America's young. The struggle for civil rights.
We made some level ground.
Caught on fire. In the absence of a male role model for her children, Mrs. Kennedy had been leaning on her husband's brother, Robert. But that too ended when, like his brother 5 years before, he was cut down by an assassin.
Pray that what he was to us, what he wished for others, will someday come to pass for all the world.
With Bobby gone, Mrs. Kennedy looked outside the Kennedy clan and outside the country for support for her and her children.
By 1968, I think she had gotten a little bit tired of being a professional widow as she had been for 5 years. And when Robert Kennedy was murdered, she was said to say in private, "If America is killing Kennedys, I want no part of this country."
Mrs. Kennedy had become friends with Aristotle Onassis in 1963. He kept in touch with her after the president was shot, showering her with gifts. She married Onassis in 1968 after Robert Kennedy's funeral. Once the first lady, now she was Jackie O. The nation thought her a traitor or worse.
Well, I think the country felt that they owned her. She was the symbol of that period about which people were very nostalgic. And let's face it, Aristotle Onassis was no Jack Kennedy.
But he was fabulously wealthy. For money, so it was thought, she abandoned Kennedys and country.
To some degree, marrying Aristotle Onassis not only brought her protection, but it was a way of liberating her from the role she had had for 5 years, pulling herself off the pedestal so to some extent she could begin living like a normal human being again.
But the money did not buy compatibility. They were from two different worlds, his peasant and Mediterranean, hers patrician and Long Island Sound. So unhappy, she went on $100,000 shopping binges. Speed shopping, her friends called it. By 1975, the elder Onassis was alienated from his wife and himself in failing health. He died in a Paris hospital. Jackie O was not at the deathbed. She'd been skiing in New Hampshire. Onassis' daughter, Christina, and Mrs. Onassis fought bitterly over the $1 billion estate. The strong-willed Mrs. Onassis demanded a flat settlement of $26 million, and after 18 months of wrangling, she got it. She and her children were set. So much so, she went back to New York to work as a book editor for $10,000 a year. Some of her authors, Carly Simon, Bill Moyers, and her biggest triumph, acquiring Michael Jackson's memoirs.
You know, there's an impression, I fear, that this was, she was a dilettante. Certainly with her financial security and her having done her duty to the nation, she could have easily elected to go shopping or be one of the women who lunch. Instead, for the last half of her adult life, she applied herself to a field that she had a great passion for and a great, great competence in.
Once an Andy Warhol subject, her celebrity power stayed strong. In 1983, a judge forbade ads using a Mrs. Onassis lookalike. Her public life toned down, but it was still Tony. Family took precedence. John John grew up. Caroline gave her grandchildren. Though Jackie kept the name Onassis, she worked to reinforce ties with the Kennedys and to keep JFK's memory alive. Quietly, she took up with a businessman, Maurice Templesman, another old friend. He was by her side when she died, as was her family. And what began as a public life defined mainly by the men she was with ended as a life very much her own.
And even when she lost her husband, I mean, she went on and she's been very successful, and I think she has a lot to, we have a lot to thank her for.
Tremendous lady, has class and style, and tremendous courage, I think, in view of all the difficulties she had in her life.
Jacqueline Kennedy, à l'âge de 64 ans, l'ancienne première dame des États-Unis, a été vaincue.
Kennedy Onassis, die Witwe des 1963 ermordeten Präsidenten John F. Kennedy, starb in...
Her children and members of the Kennedy family were at her bedside when she died. She was 64.
There's been an enormous outpouring of good wishes from everyone, both in New York and beyond, and I speak for all of our family and we say we're extremely grateful. Everyone's been very generous, and I hope now that, you know, we can just have these next couple of days in relative peace.
On this sad occasion, Hillary and I join our nation in mourning the loss of Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis. Jackie Kennedy Onassis was a model of courage and dignity for all Americans and all the world. More than any other woman of her time, she captivated our nation and the world with her intelligence, her elegance, and her grace. Even in the face of impossible tragedy, she carried the grief of her family and our entire nation with a calm power that somehow reassured all the rest of us. As First Lady, Mrs. Onassis had an uncommon appreciation of the culture that awakened us to all the beauty of our own heritage. She loved art and music, poetry and books, history and architecture, and all matters that enrich the human spirit. She was equally passionate about improving the human condition. She abhorred discrimination of all kinds, and through small, quiet gestures, she stirred the nation's conscience. She was the first lady to hire a mentally retarded employee here at the White House. And she made certain for the first time that minority children were all welcome in the White House nursery. She and President Kennedy embodied such vitality, such optimism, such pride in our nation. They inspired an entire generation of young Americans to see the nobility of helping others and to get involved in public service. When I became president, I was fortunate enough to get to know Mrs. Onassis better and to see her and her children as friends, as well as important American history models and good citizens. I can say that as much as anything else today, I am grateful for her incredible generosity to Hillary and to Chelsea, the way she shared her thoughts on everything from how to raise children in the White House to ideas about historic preservation to her favorite current books. We hope that Mrs. Onassis' children, John and Caroline, and her grandchildren find solace in the extraordinary contribution she made to our country. Our thoughts and prayers are with her children and grandchildren and her entire family as we grieve over the passing of a cherished friend. Just a minute. I'd like for Hillary to say a word first, please.
I just wanted to say personally that every day this nation owes a great debt to Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis. And the nation has lost a treasure, and our family has lost a dear friend. We stand here in one of the many legacies that she has given to this house and to our country, in this garden, which is named for her, which she helped to realize. If she taught us anything, it was to know the meaning of responsibility to one's family and to one's community. Her great gift of grace and style and dignity and heroism is an example that will live through the ages. As a mother, she was selflessly devoted to her children and never wavered in the value she placed on being a mother and more recently a grandmother. She once explained the importance of spending time with family and said, if you bungle raising your children, I don't think whatever else you do matters very much. She was a great support to me personally. When I started talking with her in the summer of 1992 about the challenges and opportunities of being in this position and how she had managed so well to carve out the space and privacy that children need to grow into what they have a right to become. She will always be more than a great first lady. She was a great woman and a great friend, and all of us will miss her very much.
Thank you.
And so we come to the time of summing up. Summing up one woman's life, one woman's story, which became, in small and large ways, part of the stories of all our lives. Here is CNN's Bruce Morton.
She was born to a gentle life and to privacy, and she tried all of her 64 years to keep life gentle and private. She couldn't always do that. She couldn't in part because of the dashing young politician she married, the handsome senator from Massachusetts, war hero, sailor, who could and did win many hearts.
Church, it's a real storybook wedding. A radiant bride, the former Jacqueline Bouvier, and a handsome groom.
They married and she met the Klan, met Rose and Joe and all the rest. She met the Klan, but never quite joined it. Part of herself, at least, she always kept to herself. But she learned how to do the family things, campaign, for instance, look glamorous amidst kids and dogs and boats, for instance. She did that better than anyone.
I look forward to meeting all of you this fall as soon as the Senate is out.
And she was a good campaigner. The country was rousing from the Eisenhower years, good years, many thought, but perhaps a little dull. And when John Kennedy ran for president, the country scented change and action coming. Jacqueline Kennedy spoke Spanish to voters who spoke Spanish. Later, as First Lady, she would charm grumpy Charles de Gaulle in French. Back then, people talked about ugly Americans, cultural ignoramuses. It was harder to do that when Pablo Casals played his cello in the Kennedy White House, when Jacqueline Kennedy got rid of the 1950s department store furniture and replaced it with antiques that celebrated America's past. She made the world see that Americans, too, could love beauty and music. She classed up our national act, Camelot, we'd call it later.
President Kennedy has been assassinated. It's official now. The president is dead.
And then she did something no other first lady ever did, ever had to do. After the awful day in Dallas, she taught us how to mourn. Television brought the country together, of course, but it brought us together to follow her ritual. And in our millions, we did. She was just 34 when her husband was murdered, but she walked through those 4 days, veiled and black-gowned, with fierce determination and restraint. She got it right, and helped us get it right, and helped the world see not a nation of wackos waving guns, but a country united, grieving for a dead leader. Hundreds of thousands of us wrote her letters, and she said she would read and answer them when she could bear it. Later, she left us, married a very rich man who could give her and her children something they perhaps couldn't have found in America. He gave them privacy, a chance to grow up away from paparazzi, away from the pressure of having to be public Kennedys always. After Aristotle Onassis died, she came home a private person still. The children were grown and successful. She joined the Kennedys at public functions, a library dedication, an award ceremony, but she still hadn't joined the Klan. She lived her own life, worked at her own job, had her own friends, private, as she wished to be. She had been through hard times, she said once, and come through them sane, and she was proud of that. She was somebody in those White House days the country looked up to. If you wanted a royal family, the Kennedys were as close as this democracy could get. She was a feminist, She was a lady. She was all class. And she graced her time.
She will be buried at Arlington National Cemetery near the eternal flame that marks the grave of her late husband, President John F. Kennedy. Gone now, the banker's daughter who grew up to be a politician's wife, a first lady, a singular lady, Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis, 1929-1994. For everyone at CNN Special Reports, I'm Stephen Prager.